Okay, so in the last lecture, we comprehended how the magnetic forces act on a rectangular loop of a current carrying conductor. And for that case, we only studied about a specific scenario in which the loop of current, the current carrying loop, was parallel to the magnetic field that was being applied in the vicinity of that current carrying loop. And we found out that the torque that was acting on the two conductors, the other two conductors, on the force on the other two conductors was zero, as we saw, but the total torque due to force F1 and due to the force F3, and that sums up to be y hat I a b naught. But at the end of that lecture, we said that this thing only applies when the conductor, even the conducting loop, and the conducting loop is parallel to B naught. Now, what happens when the conducting loop is not parallel to the B naught? Because once the torque start acting on that loop, as a result, that loop starts to rotate, and once that loop starts to rotate, that loop is now no longer parallel to the magnetic field. Just for example, in order to understand a little bit better, we'll draw a diagram that we were witnessing the current carrying loop from the bottom side. And in that case, this was the case in which these two things were parallel. But once these forces act on these conductors, as a result, this thing will start to rotate. Due to the torque, this thing will start to rotate, and this is the axis of rotation at which this loop is pivoted. So once this thing starts to rotate, it will no longer make the angle of 0 degrees with respect to this magnetic field, which is present right here. Once it starts to move, it will make some kind of angle with this magnetic field, and at that time, at that position, the torque will not be this is the maximum torque when this loop was in parallel, or the normal vector of this loop was perpendicular to the magnetic field. So he's saying that this thing is valid only when B is parallel to the plane of loop. As soon as the loop starts to rotate, the torque starts decreasing. Why? Because this thing starts to make an angle with magnetic field, and now not all the magnetic field is in the direction of this loop. There is some kind of component which is in parallel, and the other component is perpendicular, like we talked about earlier when we talked about the cross products and dot products. So he's saying that as soon as the loop starts to rotate, the torque starts decreasing, and at the end of the one quarter rotation is something like this, and the loop is totally perpendicular to the magnetic field. This is the magnetic field, this is loop, and now it's making an angle of 90 degrees. He's saying that at the end of one quarter rotation, the torque becomes zero. Why does it happen? So let's discuss this thing. And the topic for our today's lecture is magnetic field perpendicular to the axis of a rectangular loop. So magnetic field perpendicular to the axis of rectangular loop. So this is the topic for today. Now let's draw that loop once again in a different type of scenario, in a different type of perspective would be the right term to call it. This was the rectangular loop, and this is how the current was flowing. This is the direction of current. Okay, so this was the force F1 which was acting on the conductor 1, and this was the force F2 which was F3 which was acting on the conductor 3. the force on conductors 2 or conductors 1 or conductors 4, they were said to be zero, because we were saying that in both these cases the direction of current was either in parallel or anti-parallel to the direction of magnetic field. So this was the magnetic field, the direction of x, as we remember. Now he is saying that if we draw z axis, that will be obviously perpendicular to this xy plane. This is going to be the z axis. Okay, so now he is saying that this loop starts to rotate under the influence of this force and this force, or under the influence of the torque which is generated as a result of these two forces. So once this thing starts to rotate like this, obviously if at this condition the angle, the normal vector was on the z-axis, and once it starts to rotate it will make some kind of angle with z-axis, because now it's not in the xy plane. Instead it moved a little bit, it rotated a little bit around its pivoted axis. So he's saying that the field is still perpendicular to the axis of rotation, but its direction may be at an angle with respect to the loop's surface. Like if this loop is now in this position, just like this. At first the loop was in this position, the one that we discussed in the last lecture, and if now after rotating the loop is in this condition, so the angle this n hat, this is no longer along the x-axis, this is making some kind of angle with the z-axis, sorry. Now this is no longer along the z-axis, now it's making some kind of angle with the z-axis. So this is what we have depicted here. Now he's saying that it is making any kind of angle theta with respect to the loop's surface normal. Due to rotation, we may have non-zero forces on all four arms of the rectangular loop. But now he's saying that there is a possibility that there is some kind of force acting on conductor 2 and conductor 4 also, which was zero in the last case, because in that case the current, the direction of current was parallel or anti-parallel, but in this case it is not parallel or anti-parallel, it is making some kind of an angle. So there is some kind of some component which is in the direction of B naught, and that will allow another force to act on this, but that force does not have any kind of effect on the current carrying loop, because we know that the force will be perpendicular. So it will be either in this direction, if F2 is in this direction, F4 is going to be in this direction, and this thing, these two forces will cancel out each other, and they will have no effect on the rotation of this loop. So as a result, we'll not consider these forces once again, we'll ignore these forces. So he's saying that, but F2 and F4 are equal in magnitude and opposite in direction, because if you take a look at this conductor right here, the direction of current is from right hand side to left hand side, and similarly if you take a look at this conductor F4 right here, the direction of current is from left hand side to right hand side. So as a result, the equal amount of force will act on this side and this side, but they will be in opposite directions. Also it is not pivoted along this point, so there is no rotation as a result of these two forces. So once again we will ignore these two forces, and we'll talk about the forces F1 and F3 once again. So the directions of I in 1 and 3 are always perpendicular to B regardless of the magnitude of theta. Ab ye cheez hum pehle pad chuke hain ke the directions of I in 1 and 3 is always going to be perpendicular to B, because this is the direction of I and this is the direction of B naught. This is the direction of I and this is the direction of B naught, and the current's direction will always be perpendicular to the magnitude the value of B, but regardless of the magnitude of theta. So F1 and F3 have same expression as derived earlier. The value of F1 and F2 and F3 and F4, they are not going to change, they will be the same as derived earlier, but their moment arm is now changing. Why? Because we know that this is actually the direction of, if we draw B right here, this is the direction of B, and the moment arm was the distance from pivoted axis to the point at which the force was being applied, and now this is the equivalent component of this moment arm. So he's saying that right now this moment arm is making some kind of an angle, and that angle was theta. This is the same angle that N is making with Z axis, theta, because that is, as it is moving, the N vector will move along with our loop too, because it is, it always has to be perpendicular to the plane of loop. So he's saying that now the moment arm is going to be A over 2 sine theta. In this case, A over 2 sine theta. So the only thing that's changed right now is the angle. This is theta and this is A over 2 sine theta. So he's saying that the torque in this case will be modified. This was the maximum torque in last case, I, A, B. But the only thing that will be added in this, that will be modified in this expression in this case, is this sine theta. He's saying that now this sine theta has some kind of effect on the value of torque. As long as this sine theta has some kind of value, right? If we take a look at this expression, in this case, this theta was 90 degrees and sine theta, sine 90 was 1. This will be the maximum value. So as soon as the loop starts to rotate, sine theta will begin to reduce. Actually, the value of sine theta will begin to reduce because this is the angle. And now, sorry, this is not theta, this should be theta. From this N to this perpendicular loop, like here it was 90 degrees. Now, as soon as the loop starts to rotate, this angle will start to reduce. It will come down from 90 degrees. And as soon as the value of this angle reduces, it will come to sine 60, then it will come to sine 30. The value of sine theta will be reduced also. So this will go, this will be less than 1, and this will be further less than sine 60 degrees. As soon as this perpendicular, this loop becomes perpendicular with respect to the magnetic field that was applied, this angle will now become 0 degrees. And at this point, the value of sine 0 will be 0, and at this point the value of torque will be 0. And once it passes through this direction, the theta will start to rise once again, but it will be in the negative direction. So the torque will be negative from further, theta is going to be negative, and the torque will be equals to the negative of this thing that we derived earlier in the other scenario. So right now what's happening is that we ended up with a modified form of torque equation, and this was this included the expression sine theta in it, and it has considered the effect of the angle of that thing. So if we take a look at this thing more generically, we'll say that once we talk about, if you will remember that you have talked about a DC generator, a simplest form of DC generator, or the simplest form of DC motor in FSC or in metric also, while talking about those things, you can say that there is a scenario like this at which the torque becomes zero, and if the torque becomes zero at this point, and after this, after this loop has crossed this thing, the torque will become negative. It means that if the torque was in clockwise direction earlier, the next time the time at which this loop crosses this axis, it comes here. Now the torque will start to act in counterclockwise direction. So this means that our motor couldn't work, and it will start vibrating, and eventually it will burn out, or eventually it will be stationary, because at this point this is the F1, this is the F2, and these two forces won't be able to make this loop rotate. So how does it work when we talk about the DC motor or DC generator? In that case, if you'll remember, there was a split ring that was attached to this loop. It was attached to this loop right here in this way, and once it crosses that vertical position, the terminals, this terminal will connect to this one, and this terminal will connect to this one, and this way the polarity of this loop will reverse, and the torque that will act on that loop will once again be in the clockwise direction. So the loop will pass this position at which the torque is zero under the influence of the inertia, and once it passes, the polarity will be reversed, and as a result the torque will again be clockwise, and this will keep our motor rotating. So this is a thing that this is a question that can arise in your mind, that if after crossing that vertical position, the torque is going to be reversed, then how does a DC motor work? So we have explained that thing by saying that once it crosses that vertical axis, we had used the thing that called split rings, and the purpose of those split rings was to reverse the polarity of our coil, so that the direction of torque remains the same. So this was the thing that I wanted to divert your attention to. So he is saying that this expression is for a single loop of current carrying conductor under the influence of any external magnetic field B naught, and if there are multiple loops, if there are n number of loops, then this will further modify to its next shape, in which it will be called NIAB sine theta. And once again, this Y hat can be changed once we will talk about more generic things, but so far let's keep it this way. He's saying that now this is this torque equation is equals to NIAB sine theta, and this N is total number of loops. Okay, so he's saying that the quantity NIA is called magnetic moment of the loop. The term NIA is called magnetic moment of the loop. It may be regarded as a vector M with the direction N hat. N hat is the surface normal of the loop, as we have studied already, and is generally governed by right hand rule. So curl your fingers in the direction of the current, and thumb will point out in the direction of N hat, and if your thumb is pointing towards the direction of current, then your fingers which are curling, this will give you the direction of N hat. So M, which is moment arm, he is saying that N I A is basically the moment arm, and N hat is the perpendicular vector, perpendicular according to the surface of the loop. Okay, so he's saying that it is governed by right hand rule. The unit for this thing is ampere meter square, and in terms of M, if we want to modify this equation further and write the value of torque in terms of M, that will come out to be M cross B. This M is Y hat NIA, and this B is B, and why have we written it in the form of cross product? Because we have this sine theta right here, and we have this NIAB with a perpendicular vector. So this is another way of representing the torque which is produced in a current carrying loop. He is saying that this expression is valid for any orientation of B and any shape of loop. The next thing that we're going to study is a law which is called Biot-Savart law. The thing that I told you before is that whenever we will study something in magnetostatics, we'll always find a counterpart of that thing in electrostatics. So the Biot-Savart law is basically the counterpart of Coulomb's law. The Coulomb's law that was in electrostatics, which was used to find the value, which was used to compute the value of electric field E, what Coulomb's law was in electrostatics, the same type of role the Biot-Savart law has in magnetostatics. The Coulomb's law was used to calculate the value of E, while in the Biot-Savart law, we will use this law to calculate the value of H. H is basically the magnetic field intensity, which is the counterpart of electric field intensity in electrostatics. So previously, we were using B, the magnetic flux density, to refer to the magnetic field's presence. Now, in Biot-Savart law, we will work with magnetic field intensity instead. So for the most materials, as we discussed earlier, for the most materials, B is equals to mu H, and we said that this mu for the most materials is constant except the ferromagnetic materials, and we discussed a little bit about that too, but we'll discuss the permeability of ferromagnetic materials in detail when we'll study the magnetic properties of magnetic materials. But right now he's saying that for the most materials, B is equals to mu H. So the current induces magnetic fields that form closed loop around the wire. We know that whenever there is some kind of current which is flowing through a wire, there is a magnetic field that is produced due to the passage of that current through that wire. It is, and this magnetic field will be in the form of closed loop. We have studied this thing a number of times in different grades throughout our educational career. So he's saying that Jean Biot and Felix Savart, they basically worked on deriving an expression that links the magnetic field intensity H at any point with the amount of current that basically is generating H. So he's saying that if there is a current I which is generating a magnetic field whose intensity is H, so Jean Biot and Felix Savart, they worked on an expression in order to link these two things, in order to link the current that is generating the magnetic field intensity H. So the statement for Biot-Savart law is the differential magnetic field dH, the small part of magnetic field dH generated by a steady current I flowing through differential length dl is basically, he's saying that the differential magnetic field intensity which was generated by a steady current I which was flowing through this wire or any wire for that matter through a differential length dl. We know that depict the differential length dl in a vector form, and that vector is basically showing us the direction of the flow of current. So he's saying that this dh is equals to I over 4 pi dl cross r hat over r square, and the magnitude of this magnetic field intensity, it will be depicted in the units of ampere per meter. So if you take a look at this law, you'll see that it has a resemblance to Coulomb's law, which was 1 over 4 pi epsilon and q over r square. So this is pretty similar to that thing, but what we have done is that we have changed q with I dl. And the other thing that the other difference that we can spot right here is this cross product. We didn't have this type of cross product in Coulomb's law, but we had a unit vector which was used to describe the direction of electric field. So basically this cross product is also depicting the direction of this magnetic field intensity. So it is pretty similar to the Coulomb's law, but I want you to compare these two things so that it becomes easy for you to understand and it becomes easy for you to memorize, to keep these things in mind that this Biot-Savart law is basically a counterpart of Coulomb's law. So our vector here is basically the distance vector between DL and observation point, just like it was in Coulomb's law. So the direction of H is such that the DL is along the direction of I, and R hat points from the current element to the observation point. So he's saying that if this is the observation point, R hat, and we say that this is the DL through which that current was flowing in this direction, is saying that this basically is R hat. So he's saying that R hat points from the current element to the observation point. So this is R hat. This is R vector, and this direction with unity magnitude is basically R hat. So according to the equation, dH varies as inversely proportional to the square of the distance between these two things. This is pretty similar to E. In E, there was also a term R square in the denominator, which means that if we take a look at, yeah, if we calculate the value of E far away from the point charge, the value of E is going to be lesser and lesser. The same is the case with magnetic field intensity, that if this point is far away as compared to this, the magnetic field intensity is going to be less. So the value of magnetic field intensity varies inversely square of R. This is a similarity in between these two laws. So unlike E, whose direction was parallel to R, now we're talking about the difference between E and H. He's saying that unlike E, where the diffraction direction was parallel to R, the direction of H is orthogonal to the plane containing DL and R hat. So we have already talked about this, that this was basically the equation for E. And if we take a look at the equation for DH, he is saying that the direction of E was in the direction of R, but in case of DH, in the case of magnetic field intensity, the direction of magnetic field intensity is going to be orthogonal to the plane which is containing DL and R hat. In order to understand this thing a little bit more efficiently, we'll take an example of this conductor. This conductor is basically carrying a current, and the direction of current is like this. Okay, so we're taking a DL. If we say that this is DL, the direction of DL will be in the direction of current. And if we say that we want to know what is the direction of H at this point, what we'll do is that we will curl our fingers from DL towards R hat, and the thumb will point us in the direction of magnetic field intensity. So if this was DL, this was the vector DL, let's draw it with some other color. This is the direction of DL, and this is the direction of R hat. Just like we said, that it will direct from the current carrying part towards the observation point, and we curl our fingers from DL towards R hat, then we'll see that the thumb will point towards the direction which is coming out of the screen. So we'll say that the direction of magnetic field intensity at this point will be coming out of the screen, and we depicted that direction by the dot. Now if he's saying that this is another point P, and he wants us to calculate, to estimate the direction of H at this point, once again we'll use Biot-Savart law in order to find estimate the direction of H. And according to Biot-Savart law, now the direction of R hat is going to be like this, and the direction of DL is like this. And if now you curl your finger from DL towards R hat, you'll see that your thumb will point into the screen. So now the direction of H at this point is into the screen, and we can depict this thing by mentioning across. So you'll see that as you have changed the point of observation, you'll see that the direction of magnetic field intensity has changed as well. This is the thing that we can see in this scenario as well, because when we draw this conductor, we'll see that if our thumb will point in the direction of this current, the fingers that we curl will tell us the direction of magnetic field. And if we mention that magnetic field, the direction of that magnetic field in the form of dots and crosses, we'll see that at this point the direction of magnetic field will be into the plane, and at this point it will come out of the plane. So this shows that it is in the form of a closed loop. Same thing we can see here. So he is saying that to determine the total magnetic field H, now this was the expression for differential part, and if we want to compute the total magnetic field H due to a current carrying conductor, all we have to do is to we have to take the integrals from both sides. So this will be I over 4 pi an integral of dl cross r hat divided by r square, and this integral will be according to this differential length. So if we integrate this thing for this whole length of wire, as a result we'll get the total magnetic field intensity that is being generated due to the presence of current which is passing through, a steady current which is passing through this wire. So this is Biot-Savart law. Also keep in mind that the unit of this magnetic field intensity will always be ampere per meter. Now he's saying that we have been given the value of JS instead of I, or we have been given the value of JV instead of I. We know that we had three types of charge distributions, current distributions. One was JS, which was surface current density. This was volumetric current density. And I was line current, which was equals to the current. And we knew that this I was a scalar quantity and these JS and JV were vector quantities. And the unit for JV was ampere per meter square, and the unit for JS was ampere per meter, and the unit for I was ampere. He is saying that Biot-Savart law may also be expressed in terms of distributed current sources like JV, JS. So how do we modify this thing? How do we modify this expression if we want to calculate the value of magnetic field intensity when we have been given the value of JS instead of I? So for that case, the Biot-Savart law will be modified. The expression will be modified in this way. We'll know that the value of I dl, what is the unit of this thing? I dl, this is ampere meter. This will be equals to JS ds, and this is equals to JV dv. So this will be ampere, this will be ampere meter, this will be ampere meter, because JS was ampere per meter and ds was meter square. So ampere meter, similarly JV was ampere per meter square and dv was meter cube. So this is ampere meter, this is ampere meter, this is ampere meter. So that means that if we want to express this term in the form of current density, then we will have to replace idl with jsds or jv dv in case of volumetric current density. So for surface current density, this thing, this equation will be modified in this way. Now we'll have JS vector cross r hat and ds divided by r square, and for volumetric current density this will be modified. This integral is now according to this surface, as it is evident from this equation. H is equals to 1 over 4 pi now jv cross r hat, and now this integral is going to be a volumetric integral. So now if we have the value of js, we need we know how to calculate the value of h. If we have the value of jv, we know how to calculate the value of h. And if we have the value of I2, which is the most simple case, we know how to calculate the value of H2. So we have three equations for all those scenarios. So the topic for this thing was magnetic field due to the surface and volumetric current distributions. So I hope you understood what was being said in this topic. This is it. I think this is it for today. We'll talk about an example in which we will calculate the value of magnetic field for a linear conductor. We will apply these expressions of Biot-Savart law that we have studied in this lecture. But that example is pretty complicated, and for in order to understand that example, we'll need a lot of time. So I guess we'll talk about that example in the next lecture. This is it for today. If you have any questions or queries, you are welcome to ask them in the interactive session. Thank you so much.